What's up, everybody? My name is Talk to Pop, and if you don't know me, you can follow me on social media at Talk to Pop, T-A-L-K, the number 2 P-O-P-S, and I run one of the most popular, at least in my opinion, social media platforms for millennials. Based here in Atlanta, we are pro the culture, you know, everything that's really trending, but more importantly, we kind of sit outside of that gossip kind of piece. We actually do real research and, you know, break different topics to start conversations.
There's a lot of industries right now that are suffering because of what's going on, but the digital side is obviously booming. So what's that been like for you, somebody who runs this massive page, over 200,000 followers, right?
Yeah, actually about to hit 300,000.
Okay, all right.
Literally, we were already kind of running full steam because, like I said, I work with J1 over at Pandora. I do a lot of things like in radio, you know, all over. So one day when this corona thing just happened, I woke up in the morning and my inbox and my emails were just flooded. And I'm like, what is going on? And I mean, advertisements and partnerships and interviews and just all kind of things were just flat. I said, okay, this cannot be a direct effect of the coronavirus. And sure and behold, it was, because I reached out to a couple of my other friends who run platforms, and they were like, yeah, dude, we've been blowing up as well. So what happened, I guess, is that the demand grew and the workload grew, but the people in the hands aren't physically able to be there anymore. You know what I mean? So less resources and more demands, if anything, if that's the struggle that I'm facing right now.
Yeah, I mean, it's not a bad struggle to have. It's like too much work.
Yeah, it's not.
How have you been managing that remotely?
I wasn't operating in case of an emergency like this, so we didn't have remote plans in place. Yeah, we do our thing. I have other interns and things like that who help me. They do content, but we didn't have a solid form because we typically meet. We do a lot of different things like that, and so, you know, trying to get different, learning new technologies and like, you know, figure out different ways like Asana with task managers and, you know, things like that, a way to stay in communication without having to actually meet up.
Kind of curious from your end, how have you been keeping, like you said, your team, you have interns that are remote. How have you been trying to keep up the energy, keep the creative juices flowing? How have you been doing that?
So one thing I'd like for the Talk to Pops culture and with my team and just a couple of our interns, like, we like to be lit. And so I try to turn up and do different fun things all the time to keep us going. We watch a lot of, like, sometimes we'll come together and we'll watch a lot of different movies, documentaries, because we get inspired by creating some of the content we do. I think, I don't know if you've been on my page recently, but I just did a DeBarge post. Now, I've always been a big DeBarge fan, but I was able to, we were watching something on YouTube, me and a couple of my team members, and we were like, oh, wouldn't it be great to do something around this? And, you know, we just kind of did it, and it had a great response to it. So, yeah, it's just really been trying to stay lit, just staying on the phone. Maybe, like, I thought the other day we did, like, a happy hour with each other on FaceTime, you know, things like that, and just, you know, just really staying at it for the most part, keeping the momentum up.
My girl who runs partnerships over at Empire, she was talking a lot about how she was shifting from, like, all these in-person partnerships at events and concerts and, you know, festivals, to now shifting to, like, digital strategy. And it's people who have always done these in-person jobs are now having to shift their roles and think more digitally. But it's definitely, you know, key for people like you who this is their bread and butter. And now you're, like, the authority on culture.
It's crazy because, I mean, I started Talk to Pops 3 years ago. I went to Morehouse, so I graduated from Morehouse in 2015, and I was working in a school, and I started, you know, I just started building Talk to Pops back then, and I finally took that leap of faith, and I said that I'm going to quit my job, and this is going to be it. I said, this is going to make me so much money, you guys understand, and people literally looked at me like I was crazy. And this is back in like early 2017, maybe 2016 a little bit. So people weren't like, Instagram was still new, social media wasn't new, but it was still, you know, being introduced to a lot of older executives and people who really make the decisions. And so it was just funny because I was just looking back, like, this is wild how I went from being something to having a vision to being in demand right now for calls like this. I mean, granted, the coronavirus is devastating, and I send my heart out to a lot of the families and the people who are experiencing the symptoms and, you know, and who are affected by it. I mean, me personally, I thought that I was going to be affected big time, but it just goes to show that having a vision and making sure you stick with it, because I never thought that something like this would catapult the digital industry the way it has, honestly.
Yeah, and I'm glad you mentioned, by the way, that, like, you know, as I've been having these conversations, it's so interesting who you talk to, because some people are on the different side of the spectrum where they're really trying to find their grounding and they're going through a tough time. And then, you know, you have, I think it's important to show both sides of the coin, because then you also have people like yourself who, unfortunately, this is, you know, unforeseen circumstances, and it's obviously very traumatic and people are suffering. But then you have the reality, which is this is going to change the way we work as a culture for the foreseeable future. I mean, even once we get back to the office and once this all passes, I don't think our lives are going to go back to how they were pre-corona. I think a lot of things have happened now that have made people realize there are sometimes better and more optimized ways to do things. And you're like a great case study in this. I mean, I was talking to J1 yesterday about D-Nice is another one. I mean, you know, people are thinking,
yeah,
this guy's not getting booked. He has all these live events. He's not going to be able to perform. And he took lemons and turned them into lemonade and has had more exposure than ever. So I think it's important to show people who are finding, I don't want to call it success, but they're finding other venues and paths during this time as well.
It just goes, like, again, it goes to show that we have to shift as an industry overall, as an economy. The economy has to move towards being more digital. And just, you know, just really opening their eyes to what's around us. Everything does. So a good example is this meeting could have been an email type thing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, everything does not have to be in person.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, it's a lot of things that can be done outside. And I guess that this is just proof of it. And honestly, I think everyone's really just scared right now. We don't know what to do. We don't know how to think. We don't know how to feel. It just goes to show we got to be smarter and moving forward. So you're right. Nothing is going to be the same moving forward.
You know, it's funny. I'm laughing because I have a friend who's a graphic designer in New York who's freelance, and she's just been laughing at all of us the same way. She's like, excuse me, I've been doing this. Like, everyone's complaining, like, oh, I don't know what to do with myself. Oh, I'm trapped in the house. She's like, yeah, welcome to freelance life. Okay. Like, and I'm laughing.
Yes.
Like, you're basically saying the same thing. Like, I've been about this. So as someone who has for a while now, what would be your pro tips to other people who are just now adapting to this, like, work from home lifestyle and having to keep themselves on a routine? What's some stuff you've learned over the years that's helped you kind of lock in?
Keep your mental health in check. Oftentimes we are in the house, we are isolated, we are away from people, we don't have any structure, and it sometimes causes you to doubt yourself and to doubt whether you are good enough or have enough skill or stamina to do different things. Exercise, get out the house. I mean, I have a problem with it myself, but it's something that I'm getting better with, is to actually move around. And then in my business, watching movies and things like that, that's considered work for me. So I watch 60s, 70s, 80s, all kind of movies and different videos and old performances, and find a hobby that you can take a break from and, you know, just figure out, like, maybe you want to learn how to sew, maybe you want to learn how to, like, one of the things I picked up is learning how to really do a lot of Premiere Pro, like, editing and things like that. So find a hobby that you can disconnect from if you are working and you can stop for 30 minutes to do something else. But yes, mental health, finding a hobby, and exercising.
I love that. Yeah, it's funny because I've been having a lot of these conversations, but it's so funny because I feel like all of us in the industry always complain that we don't have enough time. I'm like, oh, I really want to do that, but I just can't find the time, or oh, I want to try this thing. And it's like, all right, now you have the time. So figure it out, like,
yeah,
whatever it is. And it's so true. Like, you just made the point about how watching movies is part of your job. I think a lot of us have a hard time separating that and realizing, like, we work in culture, we work in the music industry, you know, whatever it is. And that stuff, staying on top of culture and what's happening and watching all the Megan Thee Stallion TikToks, mm-hmm, that's part of what we are. So it's important to consider that part of your job and not be up at 2 o'clock in the morning trying to make that an additional part of your work.
I think that is going to help a lot of us get our shit together. Oftentimes we rely so much on a schedule that we as human beings are naturally just not disciplined. And when placed in a position like this, it's like you either have to sink or swim, because if you're not able to do what you do from the comfort of your home, you're going to get fired. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, so it's just causing everybody to get their ish together for the most part.
Is there anything that we didn't get to talk about that you wanted to touch on, or anything you want people to know who are maybe at home going through it right now?
I guess I would like to ask you, what has been the most shocking out of all the interviews that you've done so far?
Oh, wow. I didn't expect a question for me. most shocking. I mean, I think...
It doesn't have to be names or anything, though. Just
No. I guess I think for me, the most surprising thing has been, just how tough it's been to keep the morale up. I think... honestly, this conversation with you has been super refreshing, because I think it's hard through FaceTime or it's hard through Skype, you know, I'm so used to doing these things in person. And like you were saying, like, I know you host a lot of interviews too. And it's like that energy that you can feed off of in person. And even if the other person's having a bad day, you can kind of hype them up and be like, all right, let's do this. And like, you know, like you said, you guys like to stay lit. Like, it's so much easier to do that in person. And so I think that's been, it's not necessarily a learning that came from somebody else, but just a learning for me is, you know, going into this thinking that we can just transition to, instead of doing in-person interviews, we can do digital interviews. It's like, there's a whole nother set of hurdles that come with trying to engage with somebody digitally. And people who are great talent, you know, in person and have energy, sometimes that doesn't always translate. And it's actually like the irony, because I remember years ago doing this project where we were comparing traditional celebrities like actors and musicians to digital influencers. And it's such a different skill set. Like, traditional actors go on set and they feed off energy. Digital influencers feed off the camera. They can just be by themselves. Hey guys, welcome to my YouTube, subscribe below. And so now realizing when we're doing these digital interviews with people or with talent, it's like you have to be checking for that versus just somebody who was good on stage before. So that's been a huge learning for me. And I know, have you seen the same thing?
I see a lot of people are good at what they do. You know, I see people who are great on television, who are great on radio, but when it comes to the digital things, they may just not be, you know, as savvy or, you know, or as personable as they are in other mediums. You know what I mean? And so, yeah, as a digital, I don't even know if I'm a digital influencer or not. I don't know what, I like to call myself a media influencer, which is really weird. But yeah, I like to think of it as that. But yeah, I see it. Like, this is the way that we have to learn to communicate. And when I think of like future movies, and I always see like utopias and things like that, like they do this, you know, much better, with much better technology. And this is the way of the future, you know? So everyone's going to have to definitely adapt.
Right. Well, I think that's a great point. It's like, when you think about our skill sets, when you build your resume or your LinkedIn or whatever, like no one considers that. No one's like, oh, I'm a fun digital personality. And it's so true. Like now, during this time, when, even if you're taking a
story of my life, I was like, yo, for a couple of years, I was literally like, what am I doing? People were looking at me like I'm crazy. They're like, dude, you dropped out of school, but you dropped out of work to make memes or do, like, I'm like, no, you guys don't get it. And so it was a rough struggle the first couple of years. So to see that through and now to see that it's needed, couldn't have a much better feeling.
I can vouch for you that I can feel your energy through the computer screen right now. So I don't know if you went through like training boot camp the first few years and had to figure it out, but I think everyone can learn a little bit from you. I think you should put together a workshop for how to like transfer energy digitally. What? Who would subscribe
to
that? I'm taking 10%.
Oh my gosh, that's dope. I've never thought about it like that. I think for so many years we just stay grounded and trying to prove ourselves to people that we don't realize when we've proven ourselves that it's time to actually reciprocate and to teach now. And so I'm still transitioning out of that, because I still feel like an underdog. Like, I have to fight for every little piece of opportunity we get. Just because like a lot of the older people who are the executives and the say-so-ers don't really understand. I appreciate it. Speaking with you today, the advice, everything, such good vibes. I mean, like I said, but if you ever need anything, definitely reach out to me. I'm always looking to do some new things, honestly, especially digitally now.
Yeah, I mean, same here. If there's anything that I can help you with, or anything that you think there might be good synergy, at the very least, I'm always happy to help brainstorm stuff. I'm here. I'm in my living room. I'll be here for the foreseeable future.
I know where to find you.
Exactly. Everyone knows where to find me now. So definitely, I love this so much. Thank you so much for taking the time and hanging out.